Hello, Matsy112. It's good to be with you today on this Wednesday. So I posted a video assignment for you that you should be able to do as a team. You're going to have an attendance quiz today to help you start to think about what that video should be. And so I want to see good progress this week on planning and brainstorming. And you have the weekend and early next week to film it. So hopefully you're generating some good, exciting ideas, and there will be some good prizes on the last day of class for the most outstanding videos, so stay tuned for that. So I'm still in Saudi Arabia, but I'm flying home on Friday. We'll have a video lecture again on Friday and an attendance quiz, and then I will see you in person on Monday for regular lectures on Monday, Wednesday, final exam questions and review, and then videos as well. So you will be getting back your exams and homework soon. I'm still working on the exams, but you'll see them definitely before Monday, and you should know exactly where you stand in the class going into the final. So if you have any issues with your grades or you have any questions about your grades, they need to be asked either by email or they need to be asked next week when I'm there. So I won't be in State College finals week, and so we need to talk about anything we need to talk about either this week by email or next week. And I will have office hours, and you're welcome to come and ask whatever you want in preparation for the final or to make sure you understand where you are in terms of grading. So please remember that. Please remember to communicate, and we should be able to sort out any issues either by email or in person. Okay, so today we're going to talk about super materials. So we're continuing our party or our palooza of materials in these last couple lectures. And so we're going to talk about superconductivity and super hydrophobic surfaces. So we hear a lot about these material topics, but some of the fundamentals and some of the scientific knowledge that we've gained in this class can be used to understand the really popular stuff that's out there that you read on the news or that you hear about popular culture. So anyway, we're talking about super materials today. And so first we're going to start with superconductors. And so remember, this is going to be on the final. It's all fair game. And so you should be able to take away one or two things about superconductors that you'll be able to answer on our last exam. Okay, so superconductivity is really important, and that's because electricity and the flow of charge is so important to our society. You can see, you know, the lights, the computer, everything that we value in the physical world has something to do with electricity mostly. So here are the Nobel Prizes for superconductivity. There's been a bunch of them. And so people have worked very hard on superconductivity all the way from back in 1913 when superconductivity was proposed and the first experiments were done, through the 70s and 80s, and then finally all the way to 2003 was the last Nobel Prize in superconductivity. And so this has been a really important investigation, both from a fundamental physics point of view: why do Cooper pairs exist, how does superconductivity work from a condensed matter theory and quantum mechanics point of view, but also from a technological point of view: how do you build superconductors, how do you use them, how important could they be to our society? So superconductors are worth looking at. Okay, so superconductivity was discovered by Onis way back in the early 20th century. And so you can see some of the key experiments here. And so what's cool about this history of superconductivity is that this person, Fritz London, and his brother Heinz London, also worked on superconductivity as well, and they described what's called the Meissner effect or the Meissner effect to tell us about how superconductivity works. So it's worth knowing a little bit of your science history. It's worth knowing some of the names and the keywords in this superconductivity field. And we do superconductivity research at Penn State. So if you're interested in these types of materials, they have superconductivity research in physics. Also, Professor Joan Redwing works on superconductivity in the Millennium Science Complex. And so if this is really interesting to you, you can find some experts at Penn State that do research in this area, and they can tell you more about it. Okay, so again, here's Fritz London. The London Dispersion Force is named for him, not the city, and he worked in North Carolina. He didn't work in London, but he worked on superconductivity with his brother, which is pretty cool, I think. All right. And so this Meissner effect, the way that we can describe superconductivity with a simple picture, is shown here. So we've all seen this magnetic levitation, which superconductors do. But the question is, why do superconductors levitate like that? What's going on? It's not the repulsion of two magnets. However, it's this superconductivity that really makes this work well. And this magnetic levitation is really important because the repulsion of the superconductor and the magnet allow things like maglev trains to work. And I'll show you some examples of maglev trains. You should know what they are because they're really cool and they're really fast. And so other than the Hyperloop, if that ever works out, right now we have maglev trains, and those are coming online in some of the places where they have a lot of interesting train technology, namely China and Japan right now. Okay, so what happens in this magnetic levitation or this superconducting experiment is that we have just a garden variety magnet here. So that's your usual magnet in the center. In a normal piece of matter, the magnetic field lines will interact with that normal piece of matter. So you can see the magnetic field is going right through, and it can certainly act on that matter. It can rotate. If this is magnetic, it can rotate this thing. It can change the polarization of the atoms. It can do all the stuff that magnets do, sort of normal magnetization of this conventional material. Superconductors, because they have a coherent electronic cloud, or they have coherent electrons, and we'll talk a little bit about that. Coherent means they all have the same wave function, or they move together. So this collective motion of electrons and superconductors allows this buffering of the magnetic field around the object. And this buffering of the magnetic field and this compression right here is what keeps this magnet and this superconductor separated. So this doesn't take any energy except the cooling of the superconductor, and we'll talk about why superconductors need to be cold. But this is an important facet where the magnetic field lines don't penetrate this coherent superconductor that has coherent electrons. So that's a picture, and that's one explanation for why we observe magnetic levitation in superconductors. And you've all seen this before. You can watch it on YouTube. Okay. So in a normal conductor, well, let's just show you the slide right here. So this is a lot of verbiage, but you can look at it and take notes with the slides online. But in a normal conductor, what happens is that you have a lattice. So you have some sort of lattice of copper atoms or what have you. And as the electrons move through that lattice, the electrons bounce off the atoms, or they bounce off other electrons, or you get electron scattering. And that's what causes resistance in materials. So when you take your advanced solid state course in material science, or you take some advanced physics courses, or even device physics, so if you're interested in semiconductors, electron scattering is how resistance is built up in materials. Okay, that was a little computer freeze. Now I'm back. So we were talking about electron scattering in materials, which is what causes resistance. And so that's described in this slide if you want to read all the words. What happens in superconductors is in this paragraph right here. And so what happens in superconductors is you don't have individual electrons moving through the material and bouncing off the lattice. They're bouncing off the atoms or the ions in the lattice or other electrons. In a superconductor, you get pairing of the electrons, and those pairs are called Cooper pairs. And because the electrons are paired and exchange phonons with one another, that's called coherence. And so all the electrons, or these pairs of electrons, are moving together. And that gives some very special properties in terms of the energy of those electrons. And so this idea of coherent electrons in a superconductor is what gives it magnetic levitation, like we showed on the previous plot, and also gives it zero resistance when you apply an electric field to that superconductor. So there's some technical discussion here about the energy level of those electrons. We won't focus on that, but you notice that the energy of the Cooper pair is related to KT. And so if KT is involved, you know that that's the energy available at a given temperature. And so it's really important to consider what temperature superconductors can operate at, both from a technological point of view, as well as figuring out what's going on with the energy of these coherent electrons. So you have some resources to think about that. All right. So the main feature that we can easily measure of superconductors is zero DC electrical resistance. And so that's why it's called a superconductor, because it's a great conductor. So you can get magnetic levitation that I showed before, but also you can measure current and voltage curves where you can generate high currents with zero or no voltage. Also in superconductors, once you start a current, in the material, the current will keep persisting in this material. So we can think of perhaps a magnet that looks like a donut, like we would have in an NMR, so a magnet like this, and we can start a current in that magnet, and that current, and then we take the voltage off, and the current will keep going in that magnet. We can have a superconducting magnet, and that can last for a very long time, on the order of hundreds of thousands of years. And so we have superconducting magnets, like I said, in our NMR machines in chemistry. And you'll learn about NMR if you take some advanced chemistry courses. But this issue of superconducting electromagnets is really important technologically. And also, we can do this in a closed system. NMRs have a lot of insulation around them. But right now, we fill up our NMRs with liquid helium. And so liquid helium is very expensive. We're not making any more helium on the Earth, so we need to think about how else we might get superconductivity in materials at temperatures that don't require liquid helium. All right, so this is some more technical discussion of the details of superconductors. So you can just look at this, and it will give you some more background if you're interested in some of the nitty-gritty details of what these superconductors are. All right, so how we use superconductors. Right now, you've seen this little demonstration on YouTube, but we have these things called maglev trains. Maglev trains have been proposed for a long time, almost since they figured out what superconductivity was in the 70s and could harness it. But there's a superconducting train in Shanghai. So this train travels 250 miles an hour, and it goes from the Shanghai airport to downtown Shanghai, which is 18 miles in 8 minutes. So this is the fastest train on Earth that's in regular service. This train right here is being built in Japan, and this maglev train goes 374 miles per hour, and so a five-hour car ride all of a sudden turns into 40 minutes on the train. And this is fast even for Shinkansens and other fast trains that they have in Japan and China. Those go about 150 or 200 miles an hour. And so these maglev trains go much faster than that. And they don't touch the track. Both maglev trains ride on a cushion of air. And so they have very sophisticated systems for pushing them along due to magnets in the rails. But they're levitated on air. So they're really airplanes, or they're really flying through the air just above the track due to the superconducting magnets inside the track. Now, we don't have a lot of these trains, and they're very expensive because you need to keep everything cold. You need to keep the tracks at liquid nitrogen or below temperatures in order to get this superconductivity effect. But they're working on it. They're trying to learn how to make these trains and run them. And so if you ever get to Shanghai, you can go ride on a maglev train. Soon you'll be able to take one in Japan. Okay, so the big breakthrough in superconductivity was going from about 30K, where superconductivity, they knew it would exist. They were using liquid helium or liquid hydrogen and other ultra-cold fluids, to superconductors that function up to 92K. So that's still pretty cold, but that's a huge jump, because now you can use things like liquid nitrogen. Now you can use refrigerators and access some of these temperatures. So there was a big revolution in superconductors when the temperature of operation went up. It's very expensive and very hard to get things as cold as you need to get in order to have superconductors. 30K is very cold and very expensive. But if we can raise the temperature of superconductivity, and one of the buzzwords people are talking about now is room temperature superconductivity, you might really have something that can be used in wires, it can be used in computers. Room temperature superconductor would be a huge breakthrough and a certain Nobel Prize. Okay, so here's a map of superconductors right here and timeline, so you can see some sort of general trend. There are some new materials discovered that are low temperature superconductors, but in general, we want to get these superconductors up here because these temperatures, 100, 150K, is something that we can really work with because liquid nitrogen isn't that expensive, and we can make freezers that go down to near liquid nitrogen temperatures. And so hopefully as these are cuprates for the most part, so you see that CuO in their structure. As these are developed further, people are continuing to try and push up the temperature of superconductivity, of course, up to 273K or 298K or higher. So this is where we are today. All right. So that's all there is about superconductivity. So hopefully you remember some of the key features: zero DC electrical resistance, persistent electric currents, coherent electrons, magnetic levitation between a magnet and a superconductor. And so maybe one or two of those topics will show up on homework or on the final exam. All right, now we're going to totally switch gears from the domain of physics and solid state materials to superhydrophobic surfaces. So again, a super material, but a completely different ballgame in terms of what's going on. So superhydrophobic surfaces are really interesting because they exist in nature. So this is a lotus leaf right here, and this is a drop of water on that lotus leaf. And if you tip this leaf just a little bit, the drop of water will run right off. So plants use superhydrophobic surfaces to bring water in to where they need them. They also use superhydrophobic surfaces to shed water. It turns out that some insects and plants use superhydrophobic surfaces and water to clean themselves. People are trying to make superhydrophobic surfaces for industrial coatings, maybe self-cleaning windows and other things like that. So it's really interesting to think about how these work. And so the basic idea of many superhydrophobic surfaces is that they have these very structured surfaces. And you can see two length scales of roughness on these materials. There's the big bumps, and then there's these little small nano-sized bumps. And we might call this a hierarchical surface, where we have different length scales of roughness that give the material its function. And so what's cool about superhydrophobic surfaces is maybe you can make unstainable t-shirts. And so this is one demonstration right here where you take red wine, spill it on a cloth t-shirt, and instead of soaking into the cotton, the surface repels the water and the fluid rolls right off. So what's the way we define a superhydrophobic surface scientifically is we look at what's called the contact angle, or we look at this angle between the solid surface right here and the water droplet. So you can imagine if that water droplet is really beaded up on the surface, it's very easy for it to roll around. So a hydrophobic surface is just defined where the droplet is less than 90 degrees, or the contact angle is less than 90 degrees. But a superhydrophobic surface is you need contact angles up to 160 or 170 degrees. So that droplet is barely touching that surface. And when you have that little contact between the droplet and the surface, the droplet just rolls around like a ball. So you notice many superhydrophobic surfaces have this lotus effect right at the interface. So right at the interface, there's trapped air between the material, so this is a solid surface, and the water droplet. And you can see just a couple little points of contact on there. And the surface tension of water is such that it keeps the drop intact and doesn't interact with the surface. And so that's how a lot of these super hydrophobic surfaces act. And the key is trying to make one of these. How do you make this hierarchical structure where you have both nanostructure and microstructure in one material? All right. So these are some natural and artificial superhydrophobic surfaces right here. So you can see the microstructure. So this is 10 micron scale bar right here. And you can see the nanostructured hair. So this is exactly what a lotus leaf and lots of other leaves look like on their surface. And of course, leaves are a little bit waxy, so that also helps as well. But the superhydrophobicity doesn't necessarily come from a waxy surface or a chemical reason. There's really a physical reason, namely this hierarchy of nanostructure. There's a physical reason for why we have these surfaces. And so we can make superhydrophobic surfaces out of different materials. We can make them out of polymers, we can make them out of ceramics, we can make them out of silicon, semiconductors. And so this is a cool way that we change the morphology or the shape of the material in order to get the properties that we want. Okay, so this is just some text on other interesting parts of superhydrophobic surfaces. So they can clean dirt. There's other things that go on. This self-cleaning effect is water rolls down, it catches dirt particles, and there's a lot of interesting videos on YouTube that you can see to check out superhydrophobic surfaces in action. Another use for this idea of super-resistant surfaces is to have a super surface that's resistant to aqueous solutions or water-based solutions. Coffee and wine are mostly water. And to be super oleophobic. So we might call this an omniphobic. Let me write that down because that's a good vocab word. So we have hydrophobic. Lyophobic. Lyophobic means doesn't like fat. And we have omniphobic. Which means it doesn't like anything. And so we can have these different types of surfaces, and you can imagine the interesting materials that you can make that basically resist anything. Of course, you can coat things in it as well. So we see this air trapped around this finger, and so this is a super hydrophobic surface on a finger. You pull that finger out, it's not wet anymore, and so it's completely dry because of just the very little contact between water or the fluid and the material due to that hierarchical structure. Okay, again, here's some more pictures of what this might look like. And so all you have to do as material scientists is to figure out how to get your material to have a structure like that. So again, this is on the micron length scale. And so these are micron scale pillars. And you see those teeny little dots on them. That's the nanostructure that you need to in order to form these super phobic surfaces, whether it's lyophobic or whether it's hydrophobic or super hydrophobic. And so there's lots of different examples of this, and I'm just going to show you some more pictures because they all kind of look the same, but this is the surface of a flower. And if you've ever looked very closely at flowers or dropped water on them, they don't get wet. So because you get drops on flowers, of course, but the water doesn't spread on the surface like it does on a hydrophilic surface. And so that's really interesting because if the water spread on plant leaves, it would coat the whole plant leaf. Water is very heavy, and so the plant would tip over and probably die. But because plants are a little waxy and because they have these super hydrophobic surfaces, they're able to resist wetting out by water. That's very interesting. And you can see in this case, they're using polymers and molding replicas from the actual surface of a plant. Very interesting and very cool. Might remind you a little bit of what we talked about in the very first lecture of MATSE 112 when we were talking about geck skin and the van der Waals forces between a gecko setae and a surface. So this is another type of nanostructured surface that gives you a totally different type of function. So you can go back and look at your notes if you've forgotten all of that. Another really interesting area for super resistant surfaces is this idea of slips. So slips are slippery liquid infused porous surfaces. And what they are is you take a porous material and then you put some lubricating film inside that porous material. So here's the porous material right here. You have a lubricant and then you get a very slippery surface because this lubricant interacts with the fluid. So you really have a fluid-fluid interface that's tied into this porous structure. So slips are interesting because they were invented at Harvard by Toxing Wong, and Professor Wong is here now at Penn State. And so there's a lot of interesting slips work going on here. And you can imagine companies like PPG and other sorts of companies that make coatings for a living would really like to have these highly slippery surfaces that basically shed all contaminants or shed all types of things on from the surface. So these are being looked at as coatings, ship hull coatings, advanced paints and other things like that, corrosion inhibitors, anti-fouling surfaces. And one really interesting way these slip surfaces are being used is in the inside of a ketchup bottle. So I'm not going to show you this video, but you can check out the link from the notes. But basically what happens in this video is you have the ketchup that's stuck in the bottom, and you notice this is a unique ketchup bottle because there's no ketchup stuck to the surface of the bottle. And when this person takes this bottle and pours it out, the ketchup comes right out in one shot. So you have nothing stuck in the bottom of the bottle. Same with mayonnaise. So you can check out this video. The link is in the slide right here. And you can see this mayonnaise come out all in one shot. And actually, technology like this, even though this is food and we're just talking about mayonnaise and ketchup, could save hundreds of millions of dollars a year. Think about all the stuff that's left in the bottom of bottles, all the stuff that's left in paint cans, all the stuff that's left in food canisters. There's tons of uses for these slippery surfaces where you now can get all of the product out of the container. And so we'll start to see these slippery surfaces in the products we use every day because they're working hard to commercialize them. Okay, so you've had some primers on superconductivity and super hydrophobic and super omniophobic surfaces. You'll revisit those in homework and perhaps in your final exam. Now Chris will give you a little exercise on your video, and you'll turn that in to tell me that your video is in good shape, and you're welcome to email me with questions or concerns, and I'll see you on Friday. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.